press the bell icon on the YouTube app to never miss a video from News Laundry.
Hello and welcome. Today we have with us Kavita Krishnan, Secretary of the All India Progressive Women's Association and Head of CPIML or Politburo member of the CPIML Liberation. I'd like to start with asking you, as someone who's part of the CPIML and often on national television representing the party, did you at any point have to defend a position that you personally don't stand by?
No, because most of the positions are things which I have myself been, part of shaping. Mm. So I've never really had that problem at all yet.
Does that make you different from other spokespersons? Because a few others who I spoke to said that they often had to do that, so they refused to go on channels. And can you call it out when spokespersons are not really buying into their own?
I don't know about that so much because I haven't seen too much of that. I've seen mostly pretty passionate spokespersons. Maybe the one or two occasions on which perhaps it's not like that. Mm. But for me the experience has been very different. I basically go on channels quite selectively now. Mm. I don't go very often, and I go when I have something, when I feel that our position should be taken across in a certain way. Mm. So therefore, I think it's a little different from a situation where probably, there are indefensibles which come have to be defended. When our party is being attacked, it's usually on a ground which I consider completely unacceptable. Mm. So on that ground, defending my party or standing for its positions is not an issue there.
There also seems to be some kind of a collective understanding that TV news has hit an all-time low, especially panel discussions which end up playing out more as entertainment or shouting matches. And when you're on these discussions, like, how do you find yourself in that space? What role do you define for yourself?
See, I think there are three kinds of panel discussions. So I'll quickly one is the kind you're describing, which I don't think, I would not call them news or panel discussions at all anymore. I wouldn't even call them entertainment. I would say that those are really now, their character has become, they're basically a form of propaganda. Hmm. And these are propaganda channels of a very dangerous nature. Hmm. So those are channels which I have been on in the past, but I have now quite consciously said I will not go on those. Hmm. I'll talk about my experience with that in a second. Hmm. The second kind are more kind of run-of-the-mill stuff, which is basically where I find the entire debate being, even though it's not a propaganda kind of thing, it's not very bruising, it's not very nasty of that kind, but yet there is a certain flattening out of any room for actual insights to come out. Hmm. So the anchor is so controlling of the discussion that anything which you might be wanting to contribute, which is not fitting into a preformed idea of what's okay to say, you're supposed to play out certain fixed roles, and if that's not happening, then it's difficult to get your way in. I do manage nevertheless. But that's not the completely fascist propaganda kind. The third kind, I think, is a more which is rare. There are some anchors who are actually interested in a conversation. They are interested. They don't allow things to ramble, but they do want insights to come out. They know that they've got their guests there because they would like to have some contributions.
Who are these anchors you enjoy?
Well, I think that maybe Nidhi Razdan in the NDTV has always been. It's been pleasant to be on a panel discussion with her, and even Ravish, of course, is very good. Okay, so I think, and there are some others also. I mean, even others in like Vishnu and all in NDTV and all have been good. So there, I think, and there are others also. But I'm not, it is not an exhaustive list. But I think that with the kind of things you were describing, which is basically this shouting match kind of thing, that I think is a very, when I used to go on those shows, I went because I took my time. I don't do boycotts easily. So I thought, okay, let me, you know, keep going and keep trying to disrupt that conversation and get my own thing in. So even the self-congratulatory pats on the back that the anchor would do for himself, I would disrupt that and say, no, you haven't covered so many, you know, you're covering, for instance, the Tejpal thing and being very self-righteous, but you haven't covered Sony Sori, you haven't covered the Kashmir rapes or, you know, you haven't.
But there are points when you and Arnab have been on the same side. That's when the Northeastern racist comments were made.
That's what I mean. That same side, you see, he used to call people whom he thought were part of his side.
Right.
So for instance, on the Tejpal thing, he thought he was calling me to, he called me to amplify what he was saying.
And
I ended up actually completely, I told him, no, actually, I'm consistent because I would speak out on this issue and a whole lot of other issues concerning violence against women. But you are silent. You think the media as an institution is represented by Tehelka and you can attack that, liberal media. But you don't want to look at other institutions like, for instance, the army or the police, which have also committed rape. So, you know, you don't want to look into other forms of power. You're
so
not
selective outrage.
So selective, absolutely selective and selective against liberal media and all of that. So I said, you know, I'm consistent. I'm speaking out even when the institution is liberal media. But the point is, I speak on other institutions as well. So I think my attempt used to be in those days to disrupt that. I think I stopped going when they did that discussion on, and I won't call it a discussion, it was a pillorying of Priya Pillai and the Greenpeace thing. And it's crazy because after that, this court actually upheld Priya Pillai's position, which was the obvious position. And I stopped going when I realized that when Arnab realized that I'm worsting him in his discussion, he muted the mic. And I said, you know, that is a really truly amazing thing to do, right? Because if you, you know, if you're dishing it out, be willing to, you know, get it back
as well.
And
it actually happens on a consistent level with a certain kind of people. It also, I've seen, happens to Kashmiri spokespersons.
Totally. You just mute it and, you know, you're having other people kind of literally frothing at the mouth and raving at you. Literally frothing at the mouth and like lunatics calling you names. And, you know, then that becomes, you know, the anchor is amplifying that name calling. And that's it, you know. So any kind of rational argument that you may be getting. I remember that in that discussion also, clearly I had managed to make some sense to some viewer or the other because he had these callers in and he didn't realize that, you know, he couldn't pass the callers in. So one of the callers in actually said, what Kavita is saying makes sense. She's asking, you know, on who's, is the government, why is the government not on the side of the Adivasis? That's the real question about nationalism we need to be asking. And he you know, so that caller in kind of also disrupted Arnab's point. But I stopped going after that, having written an open letter, because I said that this is a very, you know, this is a different kind of spectacle that is being created, which is a very dangerous kind of, it's not news. This is not any, this is not journalistic, this is not journalism at all. Okay, this is propaganda far worse than what the Doordarshan used to do in the, you know, 80s and in the days when that was the only channel. Because in those days, you know, I remember even Doordarshan anchors had a lot more dignity. They would not be doing this. They may be, you know, they may avoid tough issues. They may avoid asking tough questions. They may do a lot of...
But then there's also the trick of language, right? So if you just take BJP, on one hand, there's a Sambit Patra who's hysterical, who is easy also to dismiss, right? And then there's someone like Nalin Kohli who's very calm and composed. But in terms of content, they can actually be the same. It's just like for my family who watches it, they can immediately appreciate Nalin Kohli because of his calm, composed language, maybe some of the things he doesn't say. So there is also that danger of, like, for Doordarshan, which didn't say a lot of things or had more dignity. Does that really make a difference?
No, to me, not that much. I think that, in fact, I prefer that the spokesperson should be someone who is making a dignified argument, no matter who they are. So I really prefer that. Because I think if it's a cool, calm, is it cool, calm, collected? That's true, but Nalin Kohli has also tried to, in a discussion about something completely different, tried to say, oh, but she's a Naxalite host, you know, and she should be dismissed because of that, because she's anti-national. So my point is that, you know, if what I always say on such occasions is that if you want the debate to be about the topic that you have called me on, then fine. let's talk about that. I mean, the anchor's job is to keep everybody on point on that. Mm-hmm. If you're going to deflect and talk about nationalism and my party, mm-hmm. and say things about my party that are not true, mm-hmm. Then I will have to enter on that. Let's have a discussion on that. I'm more than open to talk about what the word Naxalite means, or mm-hmm. what CPIML means, or what what its history is. Let's talk about that. Mm-hmm. But clearly, that's a deflecting tactic. But I think I do make a distinction between the spokespersons who are conducting themselves in a refined way, and in a civilized way, in a sensible way, and those who are just whipping up their audience, their imagined audience, into a frenzy based on absolute nonsense, and so creating a lot of noise and spectacle,
right.
which is not, and it's a bit, it's a bullying spectacle. Mm. So I think that is very misogynistic and very, very nasty. I mean, I'm more than up to coping with it, but I'm just saying that I think that does a lot of harm to public discourse. Mm. Yeah.
And when you're on panel discussion as a secretary of the All India Progressive Women's Association and member of the CPIML, when you're called on to panel discussions, do you often have to make a distinction between these identities? Do you go, or can they be separated?
Separate the identities. Mm. My problem has not been that, one of needing to separate the identities. I don't separate the identities. I always tell each and every journalist that I speak to either describe me as IPFOS secretary or as CPIML leader. But I think my problem has been different, that a lot of people in the media need a woman's voice to say some things on gender. Mm. So they actually don't want to the organizational identity bit to come out. In fact, they tell me, oh, but that will make it political. But I have to tell them, look, I represent the work that my organization does, right? On gender also. Mm. So that is why I want you to recognize what IPWA is. I want you to recognize me as speaking there on behalf of IPWA. Mm. So that's important to me. It's not just some attempt on my part to, put in a little bit of politics. The point is that I'm not there just to, this is not just a chat in which we are just discussing gender. I'm talking about the insights that I gain from my organization's work, You happen to know me as one of the people, but the point is
that how they invite you? Do they end up inviting you only when there are gender issues, because they say, yes, Kavita will talk about...
That has happened.
Does that happen to women working on women's issues in general, that women are not invited onto?
I don't know. That you'd have to ask others. With me, I think that has happened quite a lot. Mm. But I think that then they also do invite on issues where a left perspective is called for. So that has changed, I think. Initially, after, they started calling me on debates and all suddenly after 2012. So
my point is,
I used to do the same work before that and after that. To me, my work has not changed, right? It's just that I think the media discovers someone and then wants to call them all the time. In fact, I would go on giving them options of other people in my organization and party who are more than capable of handling these debates.
But you became the face that sells for them.
They wanted that alone, because for them, then they made that. So I said that, you discovered that I exist and I can, be a useful, I can contribute to these debates. Let me introduce you to others who can also contribute to these debates and be good, So I think there's a reliance on, there's a little bit of superficiality there and a regret, unwillingness. But I think when they call for someone from the left, that has been on the whole a different experience, where to me it hasn't mattered so much that you are being called as a woman. Because in my party in Delhi, mostly it is me who has gone on the debates as a representative of our party. In fact, even other places that someone has gone, it's usually been someone from among the students, and that's usually also been a woman. So
And even in one of your articles in Guardian, I think you mentioned that politics can be a very male dominant space. What about these panel discussions? Are they also very male dominant?
They have been really bad, some of them, because male dominant in some ways more than others. Okay, so there's actually been a tendency to allow terribly misogynistic abuse on these discussions. Let me give you two examples, both involving Subramaniam Swamy, who's a leader of the BJP.
I was going to ask you about
he's actually said, and look, this is a discussion on gender, on sexual harassment.
Right.
And he was allowed by Arnab Goswami to keep on shouting that this is a Naxalite who has free sex, so she shouldn't talk. So I responded in all the ways possible to that. But my point is that the anchor wasn't doing his job, right, to actually call this out and say it's not allowed. Then on NDTV also, I remember that there was a discussion around on the juvenile justice bill, right, completely different topic. And he suddenly, I happened to mention something about a general misogynistic culture and how that contributes to rape a lot more than juveniles do, right? So the fact that we need to. So I gave an example of, you know, moral policing and saying that rapes happen, you know, foreigners are going to get raped because they dress in bikinis on the beach. No, so immediately he said the same thing. He said, you're a Naxalite and you wear a bikini, I don't mind kind of thing. You know, and this was on television.
Right.
And I told the anchor later, I said, look, you know, if you're going to call this person, you have to know how to leash him. If you are not willing to, this was Vishnu. So I remember I said, you know, you are on that discussion. If you're not going to stop him and call him out and tell him no, and it's not on topic, right? My argument was part of an argument about rape culture.
Right. And you've had this discussion with Arnob also? Because it repeatedly has happened.
I know that Vrinda Grover did. She called him up and told him that this was absolutely unacceptable because she was on the same show. And I believe in the next show when he had Subramanian Swamy on for something else, he told him you shouldn't have said that or something.
Right.
You know, but the point is that in those days, Swamy was his antagonist, you see. So was Yogi Adityanath. Yeah. Now they are his protagonists. Yeah. So that's, I know, for him, everything was about an antagonist protagonist.
Right.
And I really think that is itself a very misogynist space. You know, that kind of thing becomes a very misogynist space, right? Because you have to, you can't be tone deaf there. Even when you're a sensitive anchor who's otherwise a sensible and, good anchor, I think you have to realize that you have to be alert to the fact that you have to keep that space civil for women, civil in general, of course. You have to make sure that people are not able to use communal or casteist
abuse. Is it better when there are women anchoring shows? Like if there was an Anjana Om Kashyap or a Navika?
Anjana Om Kashyap, to give you an instance, not a good experience at all. Let me describe quickly two instances I had. One was a show to discuss what happened with Gurmehar Kaur. Okay. So there she had Sambit Patra as well as Rakesh Sinha on her show from the right wing side.
She had two.
And this was an audience-based show.
Right.
So Sambit tried to immediately say that Kavita, because she speaks about women who've been raped in Kashmir by the army, is somebody who calls our army rapists. And he asked the audience, is she not anti-national and all of that. Anjana completely allowed all this line of questioning. She didn't she didn't stop it or question it at all.
In fact, she was quiet until everybody on the panel started saying Anjana.
Yes. So he said, I want to ask the audience to ask. So he egged on somebody from the ABVP in the audience to ask me to say Vande Mataram on the show. Okay, say Vande Mataram. Are you willing to say, or something like that, or Bharat Mata Ki Jai or something. So I said, my point is that, or something of the kind, okay, some slogan of nationalism. So I wanted to make the point that, you see, I'm talking, you know, you are trying to say that I can't talk about women raped in Kashmir. Are you considering them part of Bharat or whatever it is, all this Mother India or whatever it is? If you're unwilling to, if they are by definition liars because they are Kashmiri women, what are you saying to them? Are you saying, he wanted me to say Kashmir is an integral part of India, correct? So I said,
what was Anjana doing?
Anjana not only allowed this to happen, and when I was trying to give an answer, she said, no, you have to answer yes or no, you are trying to avoid the question. And I said, you are actually allowing the only woman on the panel, on a panel discussion on rape threats to another woman, to be asked a question about how nationalist she is. Because I'm defending, women who are raped in Kashmir. What is this, What are you trying to do? I mean, I become anti-national because I say that women in Kashmir also have a right to justice against rape. Okay. So I found this really amazing. And she allowed this to happen. Not only that, in another show also where I had pointed out on the show that Shaina Insi had made, about the Chandigarh instance, the Vikas Barala instance, stalking instance. Shaina NC had made a tweet that was very problematic. So
That's what I was going to ask. Do you is it easier to speak to women spokespersons?
No. Shaina was not on the show, but I don't remember if she was on the show. But the point is, I had pointed out that her tweet says this. Okay, and it had said something in defense of Vikas Barala, and basically implying that Vanika Kundu was lying or whatever. So I'd said something and said that she's an official spokesperson of the BJP who's defending. And Anjana, who was anchoring, said to me, why are you bringing in extraneous things? Don't bring in all these things. I said, why? How is it extraneous? You're making it political. I said, this is a spokesperson of the ruling party who is defending somebody accused of stalking. She, no, we must talk only about justice. I said, yes, but will this not obstruct justice? How is it not relevant? Then after a few, she said, no, don't teach me anchoring and all of that. After a few minutes, then she kind of must have, somebody must have pointed out to her that this tweet actually exists. So she said, okay, now I've verified the tweet, so now it's okay to talk about it. And then she
talked about it. Do you think women anchors or hosts in that sense also fall into this very misogynistic trap? Is that what happens?
No, I think that this is not so much about, you know, women anchors or male anchors. It's about basically how you understand journalism.
Right.
Okay, I think that this is about, if you're going to accept the parameters of journalism as being basically, these are, you know, a way of, how to put it? I mean, these are basically propaganda shows, right? To push a certain line of political opinion, and you are basically just staging a show for that purpose. So in a way, I call them the Leni Riefenstahls of India. So there, Leni Riefenstahl was the filmmaker who propagated Hitler as a great leader and all of that. So these are, in a way, Leni Riefenstahl was a filmmaker of better caliber. But but these are people who are basically using the medium of television to basically do propaganda for the government. So it doesn't matter.
So you don't think independent media exists in that sense?
Independent media, I think, has a struggle existing. I don't think it doesn't exist. But I think that it has a great struggle existing. There are limited anchors who are like
this. Has it moved away from television for sure?
No, television also, I think, has some room for that. For instance, you know, you do have anchors like Rajdeep, you have anchors like, who are at least, you know, who are maintaining a, you know, a civil, you know, at least it's not a one-sided propaganda. It's a discussion that can happen. You can go, you can have a civil debate, you can come away, right? You do have some, but I think you can count them on the fingers of maybe one hand. I doubt if it would reach two hands, the number of anchors who were able to do this, okay? There are some. And I think they do it, you know, I appreciate what they do because I think they are doing it in very difficult circumstances, right? But I think that on certain topics which are political, for instance, on topics like Kashmir, okay? I think that on those topics, my experience across channels has not been very good, okay? Because I think that the, you know, the room for, you know, because most debates on those issues tend to be framed through an already political or, you know, so-called nationalist lens, which is a very limited, you know, kind of, you know, if at all, it may be willing to go till the humanitarian kind of point of view, but that's about it. And so I think that that has been that I've found for quite a long time that those discussions are very, very one-sided, very, very superficial. And now, of course, they are all the more dangerous because they are openly whipping up propaganda.
So but what happens after these discussions on a channel, right? When the recorder is switched off. What is the relationship like that you end up having with other panelists on the channels? Does it get so personal for you that you are unable to hold a conversation with them? Are you friends with Subramaniam Swamy?
Now, Subramaniam Swamy, I think, is a different kettle of fish altogether because he is an absolutely abusive person. Okay?
So what happens when you meet Subramaniam Swamy?
Subramaniam Swamy, I have not had an occasion to meet luckily except once on a panel, and it was it was very disturbing because he is a very he is a very abusive person. Okay, so I think
on and off camera.
Yes, he's a very aggressive. And by the way, I know someone from his own party who said the same thing about him. A woman, I won't name her, but she said the same thing about him. Okay, because I told her, what is this kind of language that he uses, and she said, oh my God, I can't stand it either. And he's been like this always. He does it even to women, to us. So so that's him. But I think it's a different thing. I mean, with others who are on the show, it's okay.
A Sambit Patra, if you've...
I haven't had that kind of... I won't hang around waiting to have a conversation. Right. I mean, I would go my own way. But I think what is interesting is the the point is that I think women do get treated differently. One of the experiences which I don't remember if I wrote about or shared publicly or not, was an experience on NewsX where Rahul Shivshankar then was. Okay. So it was, it was on Teesta's Setalwad getting bail or whatever. And it's a very, very ridiculous conversation because he was completely biased and he was trying to be an Arnab clone, basically. So every time I would try to bring some rationality into the conversation, he would say, oh, you're being ill-behaved, you're not behaving well, you're not behaving well.
Mansplaining would happen.
You're badly behaved, because I'm badly behaved. And then at the end of the show, after the show, there was someone else on the panel who was not a right-wing person or anything of that kind, but I was speechless at what he said. Okay, because he turned around to me and to Rahul Shivshankar, who were as we were moving away from that space, and said, "Oh, if I didn't know better, then I would say you're husband and wife, because you were sparring on the show." I didn't have a comeback ready, frankly, because I was like, this man was sparring too.
Strange.
But he wouldn't say that about himself or about, other men who are sparring on all the shows or whatever, right? But because I'm a woman who's arguing, you are immediately able to say, make this. And he thought it was a joke. He thought it was fine to say such a thing to a woman co-panelist of his. Oh, hey, I would have, if I didn't know better, I would have thought you were husband and wife. I was like, this is disgusting. Okay. So I think that is there in the minds of, some...
even Rahul Shivshankar did.
Rahul Shivshankar didn't say this. Okay.
No,
this
even he didn't say anything in response.
No, but I won't blame him for, because, even I was speechless. So I have no idea what he thought about that. So that I don't lay that on him. But the point is that, this was absolutely absurd. And the fact that immediately that can be said about you, that you're being viewed in this very gendered way, even an argumentative woman, a loud woman, someone who's arguing will be told. I mean, Rahul said, behaving well. Arnab has said that to me, you're behaving badly, you behave yourself. He said, behave yourself, okay? So,
have you ever asked him to behave himself?
No, I was like, how come he's not asking those, on that particular show that he told me to behave myself? My mother pointed out, and this was something that I noticed someone on the Hoot also wrote about, that there was that raving general who had flecks of spittle near his mouth, okay? And I was like, nobody's telling him to behave himself. My mother said, he didn't say behave yourself to that chap, So, here you have someone actually, raving so badly that they're having spittle flying from their mouth. They're having frothing, they're literally frothing at the mouth. But you're not telling them to behave yourself. You're telling the woman who's trying to argue and bring some semblance of rationality into the conversation to behave herself, okay? So that is, these are just the sheer pleasures of being a woman panelist on Indian television. But, I think that, let me share with you, it's not just television, okay? I think that even when I've spoken to, my experience with speaking to the press, to people,
print journalists,
also, has not always, there's a pattern. Some of the younger journalists, some journalists who are in a, and I sympathize with them because I think they're under pressure to create, to do something, to get a story out, so they don't have time to do enough homework and all of that. So what I've found that they do is that they, without speaking to me, will end up quoting me on something, right, which they think I ought to have said, but because they haven't done their homework, right, it's not something I would ever have said, okay?
Right.
So like asking for the death penalty for some rapist, okay, or some rape accused. So I'm like, I'm
against
the death penalty.
But this is because you're a woman or?
Because they need a generic woman's name to on right. which to peg a quote, right?
Right?
So they're like, okay, let's just use Kavita Krishnan's name without speaking to her. So then I have to find out who has done the reporting for the story, find that person. Sometimes it's an agency, so then it gets carried, you know, more widely. Then I have to tell them, you know, you never spoke to me. If you had spoken to me, I would never have said give the death penalty, because I'm against the death penalty.
Right.
If you had even done your homework while crafting a quote for me, you would have found out that I'm against the death penalty.
Yeah.
So this is something which happens quite a lot, you know.
Right.
So also, so I think it's also, it's about the perils of journalism and the idea that you need a generic woman. You know, the point about being a woman here is when you're doing a story about rape or whatever, about violence,
but then
you
again
need
it's again very misogynistic because there's no need for nuance. Like
there's
if you're
no
a woman's
need for, you must be saying this.
Yeah.
So then you just need a name and you know this thing. So that's a kind of lazy journalism which also exists. Again, there are lots of print journalists who do wonderful work, and this is not to disparage them.
But from from the JNU 94 elections, right, from the time when you've often quoted the instance where the Shiv Sena person was giving a speech and you and your friend smoked incessantly just to irritate him, and he said, "Women like you will go to jail if I am voted in." Has anything changed? Because you are often called Naxalite, Maoist, anti-national, loose moral woman. Has it changed over time?
No, I think that the attack on women in political and public life, I think in general, even from women from other organizations or other parties and so on, even those parties whom I disagree with, whose ideas I don't support, I found them being attacked on misogynistic grounds by their rivals. Okay, so the idea is that if you want to argue with a woman, then you don't argue based on her political argument. You immediately say, oh, she's not married, or she's not wearing sindoor, or she's loose, or she's having free sex, or you know, you immediately shift the conversation to her personal life or her sex life or her looks or her color or whatever. So this is on social media, this is also with
which actually very interestingly does not happen with men. Like if I remember, there was the sex scandal that happened with Abhishek Manu Singhvi, right? Whether it was proven guilty or not, whether whatever happened, it was never brought up, because this is a question I asked him during the Spokesperson series. Did any anchor or spokesperson ever make a reference to that CD to mock you or put you down? He said no.
No.
But very surprisingly, it happens repeatedly.
Yes, it
for
happens
women.
To women all the time. Okay, and it doesn't matter even if it's a. And in fact, news is faked against you. I'm sure news is faked about many. Okay, news is faked about many people. For that matter, you know, even Hardik Patel, there's a sex CD put out about him. So I think. But the point is, I think that when it's a woman in public life like myself, I think the you know, the fake news which I have had put out about me has always had a salacious and something to do. It has always had sex in the headline.
Even fake news has not been gender neutral.
No. Fake news has been very deliberately gendered. So the idea is they will say that Kavita Krishnan gave a speech at Bastar or at Kannur saying Narendra Modi is impotent, and if he wants to prove otherwise, let him have sex with me. Okay, her headline of this, and there were thousands of sites, websites, and thousands of Facebook pages that carried this. Okay, hundreds. I mean, I don't count them, but they were. It was viral. Okay, and it was amazing. I mean, that there is so little you can do about it. I have filed a police complaint. Nothing has moved. Police hasn't even gotten back to me about it. Although I know who started it. There were friends who helped me locate exactly who
but
started it.
But then you
this.
Still have as much faith in the due process, if I were to ask.
No, it's not. I never had faith in the due process at all. Okay, I think that that was something completely misunderstood on my part. I don't have faith in the process. Okay, I am someone who knows exactly what the process is all about.
Right, because if anything, the list was a culmination of why the due process is such a failure.
No. I think that why the list resonated with a lot of people was undoubtedly because of this, and that is something I do appreciate. I do accept that due process is not something that has satisfied so many people. But I think my point was different. My point is that, you know, even at the end of the Me Too campaign in the US, for instance, what is it that is the outcome of that process? Now, people are trying to set up complaints committees and so on, where women in a variety of walks of life can actually get support when they come forward to complain, right? So the idea is to actually create some process and some manner of support, right? So I think that that was the outcome there, right? What we were trying to say was precisely that here. That, you know, we are also saying that women's narrative should be respected, should be believed, should be accepted, should be backed up. And, you know, it's not that you should believe, for instance, if the Supreme Court throws out a complaint of the feeble verdict, okay, and says, I won't even allow an appeal. It's a glaring, completely horrendous, you know, failure of the process, right? Of judicial process,
right? Or even with Hadia,
right?
To that extent.
Hadia, totally. So, in fact, that's exactly the comparison I've made, that Hadia's yes is not a yes and this woman's no is not
no,
a no.
No, no, no.
Okay, now, I think, but my point, I think, is that, you know, what I felt, you know, I know why I responded the way I did that time. The fact is that, you know, the person, when it's a single individual at that time compiling the list, the first day that it came out, when we did respond, that single individual was actually someone who had attacked me for standing up with the Faruqi complainant on Facebook, in a Facebook post, which she subsequently deleted. So I found it completely, you know, I found that to be a completely untrustworthy process for me. I was like, you know, if you're going to say, I believe you to so many, how come you didn't say so to the Faruqi complainant? Okay, you joined others in trolling me for supporting that complainant, right? And you trolled me, my organization, my party, for standing up with that complainant, along with a whole host of others who were doing that, right? And suddenly you become the person who's saying, I believe you. I'm not saying it's all about that individual, okay? I do see that the list and so on goes beyond that. It does resonate with a lot of people for a lot of reasons. But I think my only humble point, even now, is that instead of making it a kind of arpar kind of fight, which I still feel that a discussion among feminists about feminist ethics and feminist tactics shouldn't be, okay, my only consideration was that even after that, what are you asking? You're still asking institutions to set up complaints committees.
You're still basically saying,
and basically on all those names, what has happened? Nothing has been able to move because no one has come forward with a complaint, right? Without a complaint, nothing is able to move. You're also saying, why aren't institutions acting? But how can institutions, how are you going to hold institutions accountable? So I think instead of our focus on holding institutions accountable, I think that thing you know, went off on a detour for a bit into a pillorying campaign about some feminist voices, which I think is completely unnecessary and wrong. Again, the list also turned out, that first list turned out to be selective because there were names left out which were then, you know, appearing in other lists. So then it becomes, you know, my list versus your list versus the third list. So my point is, if there's a narrative that comes forward, even if it's an anonymous narrative, if it's a narrative, okay? For instance, in the Aziz Ansari case, it's a narrative that has come forward. That is something I will respect, and I would say that, you know, it's someone who has put out a narrative in the public domain. Even that is a process. That's fine. You know, so I won't pit that against, I won't say, oh, everything has to go according to the rule or whatever. That's not the point.
And for you, as someone who goes on so many discussions to talk about so many issues, does it often get a little thankless? Do you get tired of...
No. I don't see it as something that is to be thanked for. I assume that the, you know, it's a process of communicating. I communicate in a variety of ways. My primary means of communicating are through what I write, through what I speak on the streets, and through what I speak in, you know, activist meetings and so on. These are my primary forms of communication. Ancillary form of communication for me is what I can do through media and social media. And these are up there for what people are able to make of them, and you know, what I can, however much I can intervene in a debate and on behalf of what my politics is, and it's out there for whatever it's worth.
Do you have one person as a spokesperson who you just dread being pitted against? Who, if you have to go on a panel discussion and you're like, oh God, like if I can't get my point across with this person.
No, I can get my point across with no matter who it is. But I, as I said, it's not so much the spokesperson who's the problem.
Right.
It's the manner in which the debate or the anchor is concerned. So I do not go on some of the shows anymore because I, not because I can't get my point across. As I told you, even in that dreadful show after which I boycotted the then Times Now, I boycotted Arnab. I clearly got my point across because the caller in got my point.
Right.
But my point was that I felt that I am becoming party to a political show, a political spectacle, which is actually propagating fascism. He needs me on that show.
So even if you're negating it, just being there, you're giving into it.
Giving it legitimacy as a news panel, which I do not, I will not confer legitimacy on Republic, on Times Now, on Zee News, on NewsX. I do not consider these to be news channels at all.
Okay? And which is a, who is the one person as a spokesperson you really enjoy debating with whom you actually can engage, even if you're on completely different sides of the spectrum?
I can't think of anyone offhand like that, but I think it's been, I mean, it's been, I mean, there are some who are civil, whom, you know, one is able to have a discussion. But I can't recall offhand, you know, I've had, yeah, I remember spokespersons from the Aam Aadmi Party and so on, with which, you know, I've had very, you know, sort of, you can say heated debates over Khidki and so on, but they were civil debates. I mean, they were not, but the point is, I lay that not on the spokesperson, but
on the anchor,
Okay? Because I really think it's about that, okay? Because you have, you know, it's your, it's your space.
Right.
You are the person who is conducting that space. You have to make sure that the space is somewhere where people are able to debate without abuse.
Right.
If you become part of the problem, you become the abuser. You become someone who is labeling people as tukde tukde gang and anti-national and this and that. How on earth can a debate take place in that? So I really wish, my fervent wish is that I think no one should you know, grace these places with, you know, I feel that anyone who's interested in a sensible debate, no matter where on the political spectrum you are, should not go. Should not go, because these are not news channels.
Thank you so much, Kavita, for this. If you like this interview and want to see more of such work, subscribe to News Laundry. Remember, when advertisers pay, advertisers get served. When viewers pay, viewers are served. So subscribe to independent media.